We see your forehead.
Okay, hold on a second. I'm gonna get it straight. Okay, now it's better. Okay.
Okay.
Yes. So today's daf, Bezras Hashem, is daf Yud Gimel, and we're starting from daf Yud Beis Amud Beis, two lines from the wide lines. And the Gemara begins Mechoin. Okay, we're discussing over here that there are seven heavens. There's seven Rikiyas. From based on this Gemara, Rav Shlokish says there are Shiva Rikiyim Haim. There's seven heavens. So we discussed six of them, and now we're up to Mechoin. One of the heavens is called Mechoin. So let's start again. Okay. Hi, Lewis. We're just beginning. Yud Beis Amud Beis, second line from the wide lines. We're up to here. Mechoin. Yud Beis Amud Beis. So the Gemara says Mechoin. One of the heavens is called Mechoin. That is the worst Gehenim. That's the worst heaven. Why? Shaboy, in that heaven, Oitzra Shalik, the Eibishter keeps a vault of snow, Va'oitzra is borrowed, and a vault of hail, Va'aliyas Teloyim Roim, and the chambers of the bad dew, Va'aliyas Agolim, the bad super hail rains, V'chadra Shasufa Usa'aretz, it's the rain, it's the chamber of the hurricanes, Umaara Shalkitar in the chamber of the volcanoes. Not only is it the storage house where God keeps all the bad events that happen on this world, that God keeps in that heaven. Vidal Sashayan Shal Aish. And the door of this heaven is made out of fire. So whenever God wants to bring a bad snowstorm or a bad hurricane or a bad tsunami or whatever it is, it's in this place called Mechoin. Shenema, the Pasuk says, how do you know God has a place, a storage house where he keeps bad things? So the Pasuk says, Yiftach l'chos Hashem, Yishevdach Hashem l'chos oitzorei hatoiv. God's going to open up for you his good vault. So from there, you see that there must be like a bad vault where God keeps bad events that he wants to bring on this world, and that's in that heaven. So the Gemara says, Hani Berikia Ninhu. Hani Berikia Ninhu are those in the heaven. Hani Ba'ara Isnayu. Those are in the earth. In other words, God doesn't have them over here. God doesn't keep them in. God doesn't keep that in the in Shemayim. He keeps it on earth. Tiksev, Haliyah Hashem es Menorat, Tani Michol Taimis, Eish Uvarat, Shelag, Vikitza, Ruach Sa'ara, Oysa Devarai. It's Min Ha'aretz. God keeps it over here on earth, not in Shemayim. Amrav Yehud Amrav, David Bika Shalem Rachman, Vahidirida La'aretz. Be'emes, they were in Shemayim. And God, David was Davin Tashem, and now all those vaults where God keeps bad things happen, it's on more closer to earth. And Amar lefan of Rabbeinu Shloim, David as Melech said to Rabbeinu Shloim, Loi el chofetz rasha ata, loi gurcha b'migurcha ra. Nothing bad should be upstairs. It should be over here, down here. Tzadik Hashem, loi yugur b'migurcha ra. In your neighborhood, nothing bad should be existing. Now, what did David accomplish? David accomplished is that whenever Hashem wants to bring a bad thing on this world, it's a process. Hashem has to send a messenger down to earth to bring the bad thing that he wants to bring on earth. And so if it was upstairs in Shemayim, God, when he was angry, so to speak, he would right away bring it. Like this, it's a process. And by the time it happens, God already, maybe if somebody earns a merit, and therefore God will not let it happen. So therefore, David HaMelech was mavakish that it's the vault where God has all these bad things that he wants to bring on earth should not be in Shemayim, but it should be more closer to earth. How do you know Mechoin is called Shemayim? So again, this pasuk juxtaposes the word Shemayim with the word Mechoin. So we see that the word Mechoin is called also Shemayim. And finally, Aravos. There's a heaven called Aravos. Now, this place, Aravos, if you want to know where Hashem is, he's in the Aravos Shemayim. Okay? Shaboy, in that Aravos is Tzedek, where God does everything correctly. Mishpat, according to justice. Utsdaka means more than the justice. Lefnim Mishur Sadin. Ginze Echayim, the treasure of life. Ginze Shalom, it's the treasure house where God, if he wants to bring peace. Ginze Bracha, it's the place where, it's the treasure house where the blessing, v'nishmosen shel tzadikim, the souls of tzadikim, v'ruchais u'nishamei she'asa libaris, and all the souls and consciousness that are going to be created, vital, and the du she'asa HaKadosh Baruch Hu lehachiyos bo meisim. That du is also located in this place called Aravos. How do you know all these things, all these great things are located in the Shemayim called Aravos? So the Gemara says, Tzedek u'mishpat, how do you know Tzedek u'mishpat is in Aravos? Diksiv, Tzedek u'mishpat mechoin kisecha. Tzedek u'mishpat is found next to the Kisei HaKavod. And the Kisei HaKavod is located in Aravos. We'll see that in a moment. Tzedakah, diksiv, ayilbash tzedakah kisirian. Kisirian, it's a covering that's like staying next to God, the word tzedakah. Ginzei Chaim, Kim Kamachar Chaim. Next to God is the source of life. Ginzei Shalom, Diksiv, Yikrloi Hashem, Shalom. God called Hashem, Shalom. So basically, it's God called Shalom to be near him. Ginzei Bracha, because the Pasuk says, Yisei Bracha Meis Hashem. Nishmosen Shal Tadikim are next to Hashem. Diksiv, Ois the Nefesh, Shadini, Shuru, B'sar Chaim, Eis Hashem, Alekecha. So we see that the souls of Tadikim are right next to God. Where's God? In Aravos. Ruachais and Neshamah Shasul Hibarais, the souls that are going to be created, the Ksiv Ki Ruach Milfonai Yatov Neshmasais Ani Asisi. So if all these Neshamahs come from before Hashem, where is Hashem with his Kisei HaKavod? In this Aravos. The Tal Shasul HaKadosh Baruch Hu Liachis Mason, the special, you know, do that a God is the elixir that God is going to use to bring everybody back to life. So that is also there. The Ksiv, Geshem Nadav is Tomel Kim Nachlasecha, Vanilla Ato Chananto. So now, Shom, in that Aravos is Oifanim, Usrafim, Bechayis HaKodesh. All different types of angels are there. Umalach HaShareis, Bekisei HaKovet, and the Kisei HaKovet is there. Melech Kel Ram Ben Yisrach Shoichin Aleim Ba'Aravos. God is right there in Aravos, hovering over all these angels and all these good bracha. That's and tzedakah mishpat that we discuss. Shenema soilu l'roiche b'aravos b'kashmoy. Exalt to the one that rides in Aravos, and his name is Ka. So we see that God rides around, so to speak, in a chariot in this place called Aravos. Obviously, I'm talking figuratively speaking, but this is the way the psukim describe it. Umanala the ikri shmaim. How do I know that the word Aravos is called heaven? The ksiv, it says in the pasuk, asir rechiva rechiva. We have gzeira shava. The ksiv hacha, it says over here, solu roiche barav. It says the word roichev next to the word Aravos. Uksiv hasam, and then there's another pasuk that says roichev shmaim be'ezrecha. That Shemayim, it also juxtaposes the word Shemayim next to the word Roichev. So we can assume that Aravos is also part of Shemayim. So that is the seventh heaven. Now, what goes on by Hashem? What's surrounding Hashem? V'choshech v'onam v'aravel makif v'noisei. What surrounds Hashem is darkness and thick clouds and fog, so to speak. Shnema, yoshes choshech sischroi. That arounding God is this complete darkness of clouds that are full of, like rain clouds full of water, which are very dark type of clouds, thick, very dark clouds. So the Gemara says, okay, you're saying surrounding Hashem, so to speak, is dark clouds. Is there darkness around Hashem, around heaven? The pasuk says, who Goli Amikosoi, God reveals what's hidden, Mustarta Yoda, what's what's covered, he knows. Ma b'chashaycha, what's in the darkest? Unahoira ima shrei. Next to God, there is light. So how could you tell me next to God there's darkness when this pasuk says in Daniel that next to God there is light? Loikasha, it's not difficult. Ha, we go now to the top of the page. Ha bebate gavoi. In the outer chambers, in the inner chambers, there is light. Ha, but when there's darkness, is bebate broi. In the outer chambers, there is darkness. So to speak, in the outer chambers, there's darkness. In the inner chambers of Hashem, there is light. Okay, I'm just saying what the Gemara is saying over here. The Omer, we top of the page, you give me Omer Aleph. The Omer, so we said there's seven heavens. Comes along Rav Acha and says there's one more heaven that we didn't discuss. The Omer Rav Acha Bayankov, Oid Rakia Echad, Yesh Lamala Marosha Achayas. There's one more heaven that's above all the heads of all the Chayas, which is another name for the highest form of angels. The Ksiv, Udmis Al Roshe Chaya Rukia Ke'en Kara Chanoira. On top of the heads of this angels in the heavens is this like ice or like white, awesome ice. So, and it's very, very light up there. So again, you can, so this is all based on the Psukim in Yecheskel, which discussed the Maisei Merkava. It's the vision that Yecheskel saw about Hashem when Hashem came to him in a vision. So he describes in detail how Hashem, so to speak, looked. So ad kan yesh lechol rishus ledaber. You can discuss what's written in the Tanakh and try to understand it. Mikam ve'elech, but beyond that, ein lechol rishus ledaber. You have no permission to speak about it. So some things that are ineffable, you can't describe it, you can't talk about it. Don't try to give it mashalim. Shekein kosev b'sefer ben sura. It's written in the book called Ben Sira. Ben Sira is the ancient self-development book that appeared in the Bayesheni, and it had good stuff in there, but it also had from taking chachma from goyim also, so it never became part of Tanakh and never came, but we still, the Gemara from time to time will quote good moral expressions from the book of Ben Sira. So it's the original self-development book, and there it says b'mufla mecha al tidroi, something that's beyond your understanding, don't investigate. What's covered from you, don't search. What you're allowed to think about. This is a common phrase. You shouldn't have anything business with something that's meant to be hidden. Don't try to reveal what's hidden. So basically, this is a euphemism that if you're not ready for Kabbalah, then you have no permission to delve into it. Zokti Gemara, New Gemara, Tanya, we learned in a Braisa. Omer Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai, Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai said, here the Gemara is going to describe how many light years is the universe, so to speak, till you reach God. And in the way it goes about doing so is by a story, a story about Nebuchadnezzar. Rabbi Yochanan ben Zakkai said, Ma tshuva eshivatu baskalois rasha. What did the voice from heaven answer that evil person, which is Nebuchadnezzar, right? He says, B'sha Omar Ella Albamase of Adam El Elyon. He was such a haughty person, Nebuchadnezzar, the one that destroyed the first base of Migdash. He said, I want to go on a cloud and I want to imagine myself separate from the human race and compare myself to God. That's what he said to himself. And the Navi says that. He was the modern day Putin. So Yatzas Abaskal v'Amrloi. So a voice from heaven said to him like this: Rasha ben Rasha, you evil one, the son of an evil one. Ben Benoy shel Nimrod Harasha, you're the grandson of Nimrod Harasha. Shehimrid kala oilam kulay alav b'malchusay. He caused the whole world, so to speak, to rebel against God by bringing idolatry into the world. So you're like this evil person Nimrod. You think you want to, you know, get on a cloud and see, you'll be like a god. To reach me, says Hashem, you have to travel. How many years does an average person live? Shivim shana. Shneema, 70 years. Shneema, yameshna sembem shivim shana, bimigvuroi shmoinim shana. So your maximum, you're going to live 80 years, whatever you want. even if you live a lot of years, if you would get into a spaceship and start traveling, just to get to the first heaven will take you 500 years. It will take you 500 years to get from planet Earth to the Rekia. That means Rekia number one. We said there are seven Rekias, seven heavens. So to get to the first heaven, it will take you 500 years of traveling. To travel one whole Rekia will take you another 500 years. And then the space between each Rekia and Rekia is another 500 days, another 500 years. So there's like a vacuum, let's say a black hole between one heaven to another heaven. Lamala mehen chayas akodesh. And above all that, all those heavens, there is the holy angels. If you want to just get to the raglei achayas, the feet of those holy angels, keneged kulam, that's the size of what you just traveled. Karsile, just to touch the ankles, achayas keneged kulam, corresponds to all the amount that you travel just to get to the ankles. Shoike achayas keneged kulam, just to get to the knee, from the knee down to the ankle of these angels, that's, you'll have to fly what you've flown till now. Ruchuve achayas keneged kulam, to get to the knee of these chayas, that's also a distance corresponding. Karchechei hachayas keneged kulam, the thighs of these chayas, of these angels, that's size-wise, it's what you travel. Gufei chayas keneged kulam, tzavrei chayas keneged kulam, roshei chayas keneged kulam, karnei chayas keneged kulam. So basically what the Gemara is saying is that they will take you so long to travel just to get finished through the heavens, then to get through the chayas, everything is, you know, going up exponentially. So lamala mehen kisei hakavod. And then when you finally reach the kisei hakavod, you'll get to my chair, says God, to Nebuchadnezzar. Raglei kisei hakavod keneged, just to get to the foot of the chair, you'll have to travel the distance that you traveled until now. Kisei hakavod keneged kulam. Melech kel chai v'kayim ram nishu shoychen elam. That's the king who is the source of all life, who v'kayim means he stays forever. Ram, who is high, v'nisa, exalted, shoychen elam, he's resting on this honorable chair. So now that I explained to you, the Baskel explained to Nebuchadnezzar, just to get to God, it's infinite. You can't even imagine what kind of space there is. V'ata marta, you say, Ella, Abam say Av, you want to go onto on a thick cloud, Adame Le'elya, and you want to be like a god. Ach El Sha'ol Turad El Yakas Bar. You're going to go down to the Gehenim and to the depths of a pit. So that's the Gemara just telling you that how the universe, I don't know what it's describing over here, but unbelievable amount of space. The Gemara says, the Mishnah said, V'loi b'merkava b'yochad. You can't learn Sefer Yecheskel, the first parak of Sefer Yecheskel. You can't teach it to one student unless you tested the student that he's an intelligent a student and God-fearing student. That's what the Mishnah said. Again, this book of Yecheskel. Tanu Rabchia, Rabchia taught, Ein avol moisrun loy roshei parakim. You're allowed to give over just, you know, touch, you skim the surface of it and say, you know, a detail here, a detail there, even if the person is not such on a high level. Again, you know, if you would open up Safaria or, you know, go to your local bookstore, you will be able to buy the book of Yecheskel. We have translations, we'll have Rashi or whatever. So apparently you could touch upon it. Amar Rab Zera disagreed. Ein moishrin roshei parakim el al abezdin. You don't give the roshei parakim, the highlights, only to somebody who's the chief justice. So he's a very responsible person. Or ulachol mishalia by doyeh bekirbei. Or somebody who's totally serious, very serious person, and his heart is always nervous inside. He has some anxiety. That's the person you could teach Yecheskel. Now it's not two different people. You could only talk about a little bit of Yecheskel only to the chief justice, and you have to make sure that chief justice is not a jovial person. He's somebody who has a lot of anxiety. because it's basically the secrets of the Torah. Because basically, if you learn the Psukim describe the Eibishter. Amrab Ami, a Moisrin sister Torah, you don't give the hidden works of the Torah. Ela Mishiesh by Chamisha Dvarim. You have to have five qualities, and then you could learn Kabbalah. What are the five qualities? We're going to discuss this later, not today, but in another day. The Gemara later. Sar Chamishim, you have to be 50 years old. Unusu Panim, you have to have a lot of Zchusim merits that God forgives the Jewish people on your behalf. V'yoyetz, you know how to give advice. V'chacham, you're intelligent. Charashim, people are silent when you talk. Unavoin lachash, and you understand, you know, secrets. We'll learn all about what these qualities are that make a person worthy of to be taught the Sisrei Torah, the hidden aspects of Torah. Another statement of Rav Ami, not related to the hidden aspects of Torah, V'amar Rav Ami, Rav Ami said, Ein Meistrin Divrei Torah L'goy. You're not going to give over or teach Torah to a Gentile, a goy. Shneema, the pasuk says, Lo Yosachein L'chol Goy U'mishpatim Bal Yodom. God specifically gave the Torah to the Jewish people, and he did not give it to Goyim, and his laws were not to be known to the Goyim. This, you think, you know, doesn't come up, but if you're, so to speak, if you live out of town sometimes in a day school and you're a teacher there, often this happens that you think the students in your class are Jewish, but it happens that sometimes the father is Jewish, the mother is a goy, and the mother wants to send the child to a Jewish day school, and these shilas come up, whether the teacher can't teach the class knowing that one student in the class is not really Jewish. So this is a part of this problem that was posed to Moshe Feinstein based on this Gemara, which says you're not allowed to teach Torah to a goy. The Gemara continues, Omalei Rabbi Yochanan Rabbi Elazar. Rabbi Yochanan told Rabbi Elazar, Rabbi Elazar, Ta Agamarach B'Maisim Merkava. Let me teach you the Maisim Merkava. Again, Sefer Yecheskel, chapter 1. Amalei loy kashoi. I'm not old enough to understand it. So Rabbi Elazar refused Rabbi Yochanan's offer. Kikash, when Rabbi Elazar got a little bit older, perhaps he was younger than 50. So when he got over 50, too late. Nach nafshei Rabbi Yochanan. Rabbi Yochanan passed on and was too late to learn. Amalei Rabbi Asi. So Rabbi Asi told him, Tov v'agmar masa merkava. Come, Rabbi Elazar, I will teach you the story of the merkava. Amalei, so he bemoaned himself. Izako, if I was merited it, Gemirta Rabbi Yochanan Rabach, I would have learned the whole story of the Merkava from Rabbi Yochanan, your Rebbe. Basically, Rabbi Elazar refused to learn the Maaseh Merkava. He felt he wasn't ready. So he kept pushing Rabbi Yochanan off, and he also pushed Rabbi Asi off. The Gemara teaches you, Rabbi Yosef, Havagomi Maaseh Merkava. He was an expert in the Maaseh Merkava. Sovi the Pumpadisa have a Tony Bebaisa Bracious. The old elders of Pumpadisa were experts in understanding how to read Sefer Bracious, the Parsha Bracious of the creation of the world. So they want to do like a barter. Amrulei, so the elders of Pumpadisa said to Rabbi Yosef, Likbor Lon Mais Merkava, come teach us the Mais Merkava. You're an expert in that. Amalahu, so he said, Akmurulahu Mais Bracious, come teach me the story of Bereshis, the creation, I'll teach you the Maaseh Merkava. Basa de Agmirurin, so the Sabi of the Pompadisa taught Rabbi Yosef the Sefer Bereshis, the depth of the Maaseh Bereshis, the creation of the world. So now it's their return to get the back. Amalahu, Amrulei, so they said to him, to Rabbi Yosef, Ligbar Almar, Maaseh Merkava, come teach us Sefer Yecheskel, the story of the chariot. Amalahu, so he said to them, Tanina, I'm not teaching it to you. Why? Tanidi Bahu, Devash Vecholav Tachas L'Shenecha. Keep honey and milk under your tongue. What does that mean? It's in Shir Hashirim. Devarim Hamatukim Devash Vecholav. Things that are sweeter than honey and milk. Yehi Tachas L'Shenecha. Keep it under your tongue. Don't spread it. So therefore, I'm not teaching you the Maaseh Merkava. Now, basically, Rabbi Yosef felt, probably not, he didn't cheat them, Rabbi Yosef felt they weren't ready to learn the Maaseh Merkava. It's too deep, the secrets. Rabbi Bo Amar Mahacha. Rabbi Bo says there's another pasuk that teaches you don't spread the secret. Kivoshim, kivosim ulvashecha. So we darshin, devarim shem kivshoinish oilam. The things that are pickled away, you know, salted away, yiyatachas levushcha. Keep it under your cloak. Keep it under your coat, so to speak. So certain secrets you don't discuss. Amr Lay, Amarle, so the Sabaya Pumpedisa didn't let up. They told him, we already learned the first chapter of the first chapter of Yecheskel, and we're up to chapter number two. We learned the first chapter, and now we're up to chapter number two. So we want you to teach us chapter number two. So he told them back, you already learned the story of the Merkava. Because what the Gemara is going to say over here, and this is, if you can see on my screen over here, it's that there's two psukim in the Ma'aseh Merkava, okay? The Ma'aseh Merkava, which describe Pasuk Chav Zayin and Pasuk Chav Ches, the last two verses in the chapter, the first chapter of Yecheskel, describe the Eibishta. Ve'era ke'en chashmal. I see that, and it describes how Hashem looked, how Yecheskel viewed Hashem. Kemare Akesus, these two psukim. So they already told them, we learned these two psukim already. So he said, you don't need me anymore. So now we're up to Mesve. So the Gemara asks a question. Wait a second. You're telling me that the first chapter, including those psukim, that's the main story of this Merkava. Those are the hard psukim. But Mesve, I have a question. The Brisa says, Ad Heichen Ma'aseh Merkava. Where is the Ma'aseh Merkava? To what pasuk is considered the Ma'aseh Merkava? Rebbe Yoyme Ad Ve'era, Basra, until pasuk of Zayin, the last time it says the word Ve'era. And Rebbe Yitzchak Ad HaChashmal. So that's the question. The question is like this. According to the Brisa, up to this pasuk is considered Ma'aseh Merkava, not including this pasuk. And the second Mandiyama says just these three words are part of the Ma'aseh Merkava. I saw it looked like chashmal, right? So that is the Ma'aseh Merkava. So how could you tell me that the whole first chapter of Yecheskel is the Ma'aseh Merkava when the Brisa says up until the last pasuk? So the Gemara says no, the Brisa is more stricter. Ad ve'era up to the first chapter, up to the last pasuk, migmarinam. You could learn it in depth. That's not really the Ma'aseh Merkava. It gets worse at the end of the chapter, where it describes all the heavens and then finally gets to God himself, so to speak. Mekam ve'elach, from the word ve'era and on, masrinan rashi parakim. You give over just the highlights of what you think it means, but you touch it and then you move on. Others say Ad Ve'era Masrina Rashi Parakim. Even the first chapter, you only give over the highlights. Mikam Chelach, you have to make a retest to the guy that you're teaching. If he's smart and can understands things in riddle form, then you can teach this person. Eli, you stop there. You don't even teach the last two psukim. So the Gemara said that you could teach the first chapter. The first chapter is okay up until the last two psukim where it describes God, and that's when it becomes complicated and you're not supposed to teach it, only give over the highlights. But you can give over the highlights. So the Gemara says, Umi darshin b'chashmal, can you even darshin? Can you even study that last pasuk, the word chashmal? Well, hu hayunuka, there was this yunuka, and yunuka is an expression of somebody who's like a genius, a prodigy. There's a person in Eretz Yisrael who's now called the Yunuka. He's a very popular speaker. He's a Taimanit prodigy. You could look him up, Yunuka. So there was this prodigy, young kid, the Darsh B'chashmal. He was so smart, he darshened that posik. V'nafket nurav achalte. And a fire came down from heaven and burned him up. So you're not supposed to read that posik. So the Gemara answer is simple. Shana Yunuka delav moti zimna. He could be very smart, but that Yunuka was not old enough, and that's why the fire burned. So it's not so dangerous. Amar Rav Yehuda. Rav Yehuda said, Bram Zahula Isi Ishlatayv. Let's mention this person to good. This is a side point. Let's mention a story about somebody. And what's his name? B'chananya Mechizki Yishmoy. His name is Chananya Mechizki. Ilimolehu Nigzna Seif Yecheskel. Without him, Seif Yecheskel would be disappearing. If you read Yisefer, the book of Yecheskel, you'll read some things that describe mitzvahs and that contradict the words of the Torah. And you need to resolve those contradictions. So Ma also, what did this Chananya do? Heliloi Gimel Meyas Garbe Shemin. He brought 300 jugs of oil. Basically, he burned the night oil. And he didn't rest. V'yashabaliya udrash, and he sat in that famous attic where the great Rabbanim used to sit, so he was in a good place. Udrasha, and he solved all the contradictions in Sefer Yecheskel, where it contradicts what it's written in the Torah. Like, you know, so therefore, because let's say, for example, in Yecheskel it says nobody's allowed to touch a Nevela, even a regular Jew, and that contradicts what it says in the Torah. Anyway, so he resolved all that. So we thank him that we have a Sefer Yecheskel. Tanur Rabban, the rabbis taught. He went to yeshiva and he was learning Sefer Yecheskel. He understood the chashmal. The yotze eish mechashmal usrafatu, and a chashmal came down and burned him. Because of this tragedy, this young kid died. They wanted to hide the book of Yecheskel. Chanani Bechizkia said, this is a one-off thing. Just because this small kid was a chacham, hakol chachamim, is everybody so smart? No kids are so smart. He was a unique situation, and he was too young to learn Sefer Yecheskel, and that's why he got burned by this chashmal. It's interesting that when they chose the word electricity in creation of this of the language, a Hebrew language, they used the word chashmal, because it was considered a force of nature that was amazing, and they couldn't find the right word for it. So the authors of the Hebrew language chose the word chashmal as representing that. Interesting. Anyway, the Gemara wants to know, what is the meaning of the word chashmal? My chashmal. What is the meaning of the word chashmal? Amar Rav Yehuda said, we go to Amud Beis. Yigimel Amud Beis, Chayish Eis Mamalas. It means the holy angels that are speaking. It's an abbreviation of that. But Masnit the Tana, the Brisa, it's taught, eat them Choshes, eat them Mamalas. Sometimes they talk, and sometimes these angels speak. Sometimes they're silent, and sometimes they speak. Chash Mal. Chash, sometimes they're silent. B'shosha Dibi Yoyts Mipi HaKadosh Baruch Hu, when God is talking, so that's not polite for them to talk. Choshes, they're silent. When God is not talking, that's what they speak. So the word chashmal comes from those two words. Chosh, quiet, mal, they speak. The pasuk describes that the angels would try to peek what's in going up in God's heaven, what God is doing, and they would go up and go down like a lightning bolt. So my rotsu v'shoyf, what does it mean going quickly and coming back? They want to peek, and when they peek, they get so scared, they come right back. So what is it? How fast is that? If you see a flame coming out of a furnace, you know, the flame shoots out and comes right back. That's how fast these angels look. They try to have a peek of what's going up in heaven. My Kamaria Bozak, what does it mean? Like the fire, the flame that comes out between the sharads, when they try to refine gold, somehow the fire inside this earthenware covering, which has holes in it, somehow the flame comes out in a colorful fashion and then comes quickly back. So that's how it looked. But Eira, and Yecheskel said, I saw. So Yecheskel is describing what he saw, and he saw a wind coming from the north, a storm wind coming from the north, and a cloud, and a fire within that cloud, and there was great light, and chashmal was in the fire. So what's going on? Basically, Yecheskel is in Babylon, and he's prophesizing after God talks to him. God tells him that there is going to be a destruction of the first temple. So Lehechan Azo, where is this hurricane going? Amar Rav Yehuda, Amar Rav, Shaholach Lichpoish is Kol Ha'olam Kulay Tachas Nebuchadnezzar Rasha. It gave this hurricane in the dream, in the prophecy, was a remez, a hint that God's giving the power to Nebuchadnezzar to conquer the world. First, he's going to conquer the world, and then he will destroy the first base of Migdash. The whole kach lama, why does God give somebody so much power? God, so the goyim should not say that in a lowly nation, God gave over his children. In other words, if it was, you know, the Ugandans that destroyed the Beis HaMikdash, some small nation, we'd be a laughing stock. But now that it was Nebuchadnezzar, the great ruler of the world, who came to destroy the Beis HaMikdash, so we're not a laughing stock. It showed how important we are. Omar HaKadosh Baruch Hu, God says, Mi garam li she'ei ha-shamash la'ov de psilim. Who caused me that I should serve an idol worshippers? Because now I'm basically serving Nebuchadnezzar up the whole planet Earth so he can control it. They caused me, because the Jews do Avera and I have to destroy the Beis HaMikdash. In order for me to destroy the Beis HaMikdash, I have to give him superpowers, Nebuchadnezzar, so he controls the world, and now he can destroy the Beis HaMikdash. Lahavdil, I don't know, it's the same, but if God gave Hitler, you know, some powers at the beginning of the war, so the Jews were succumbed to a superpower, we're not the laughing stock. They were not considered an Uma Shefela, Yimach Shmam. Then Yechezkel says, Ve'era hachayas, v'hine oifan echa ba'aret. I saw one of the live, you know, the chayas, which is an angel, and he had one wing on earth, Eitzel hachayas. So is he in heaven, or is this angel on planet earth? Omar Ablazer, Ablazer explained that pasuk, Malat echachu oimid ba'aret, this one angel that is on planet earth, V'roisha, and the head of that angel, Magia Eitzel hachayas. It's such a large angel that its head reaches all the chayas, the other angels. But Snita Tana Sadalfon Shmoy. The name of that angel is called Sadalfon. Hagvoy Machaber Mahal Chamesh Mishana V'Omer Achoyer Makova. This angel is standing behind the chariot of God, the Koshek Sarim Lekoine, and it's tying crowns to put, so to speak, on God's head, so to speak, from the Tfilas of Tzadikim. So the Gemara says, what do you mean? How could you put something on God's head, so to speak? You don't know where he is. Eini, b'ksiv baruch ha-kvod Hashem im koimai. We have no idea where the Eibishter is. So, michlal de mekoimai legid yelad de leg. Nobody knows where his place is. Bless Hashem from wherever his place is, but nobody knows where his place is. Okay, so that's what he does. He, da'ama shem ha-tageh. He, after he finishes making the crown, he says the shem ha-mafayrish, the ineffable name, and the crown flies away, sits, so to speak, on God's head. And that's what we say, Keser Yitnu Lecha. One more psukim, and then we'll stop. Amar Rava. Rava said, Kol Shiro Yecheskel Ro Yeshaya. Yecheskel described how God looks, but Yeshaya also was able to see that same vision. Lama Yecheskel Daima, Leven Kfar Shiro Samela. Yecheskel is similar to a village person that sees the king. He's so, you know, you send him to Times Square, they're all excited. If you send a villager to see the king, he describes in detail. That's why in Yechezkel, it's more in detail. Lamar Yeshaya Dama, Yeshaya Hanavi is compared to Leben Krach, Shlomo HaMelech. He is like a city person that sees the king, so he's, you know, so to speak, not as shocked and awed. Omer Shlokish, Ma'idik Siv, why does it say in the Pasuk, Ashir Lashem ki go'oy go'oy? I'll sing to Hashem that he is exalted over those that are exalted. Shira Shemizgoy al Geim. God, we sing to the Eibishter who exalted over those who are exalted. What does that mean? Why God is higher than everything. Damamar, Melech Shebechayas Ari, the king of all the wild animals is the lion. Melech Shebehemas, the king of the domesticated of the animals, is Shor, is the ox. Melech Shebaifeth, the king of all birds, Nesher, is the eagle. Ba'odam is Goyaleim, and those and the person is exalted over them. So Va'kodesh Baruch Hu Misgoyal Kulam Va'kolayim Kulay. God is exalted over them and in the entire world. Basically, what it's describing is the chair of God. In the chair of God, there's a picture, a formation of a lion, an ox, a bird, eagle, and a human. So therefore, and then God sits on that chair. So God exalted over those that are exalted. So that's the meaning of that pasuk. One pasuk, ksiv echad. One pasuk says, "Udmus pnei and pnei odam, or pnei arye el ayamin labatam pnei shor masmol labatam ksiv abo pon." So one pasuk says that there was the face of God's chair is a lion and an ox. Okay, and then we describe the bird and the eagle and the human. So one of them says that there's an ox there. And then there's another pasuk describing the chair. Ksiv abo ponim le'echa pnei echa pnei kruv pnei sheni pnei adam shlishi pnei arya vi pnei nesher. In the second pasuk describing the chair, it leaves out the ox and it puts in kruv. The word kruv vi l'shar le'kachoshev. So why did the ox leave God's chair? Why is there not a picture anymore of God, of an ox on God's chair? Amar Shlokas, Shlokas explained, Yecheskel bikash olav rachmim v'afochay lekruv. Yecheskel prayed that it should turn into a kruv. We'll explain what a kruv is. Amar Lerfana, Rabbani Shlom, Kitegi asas nega, why are you putting an ox on your chair? That should remind you of the aveira that the Jews did, the ego. So take away the ox and put in a kruv. So Gemara says, my kruv. What is a picture of a kruv? Amar Abia, Amar Ababo, Karavia. It's the face of a child. Shekeg Bavel, Karin Leanuka, Ravia. In Bavel, they call a Yanuka, Ravia. A young Ravia is the face of a young child. Amale Rapapa, Labaya. Then there are two human faces on God's chair. Elamato, Dixit Pleacha, Pnea Kruv, Pnea Shem, Pnea Adam, Bashish Pnea Aria, Vervi, Pnea Nesher, Hainu Pnea Kruv, Hainu Pnea Adam. Kruv is a human face. Why is it repeated? Why do we have two human faces? So Gemara answers, Ape Ravrave, Ape Zertri. We have a mature face on the Kisei HaKavod and a baby face on the Kisei HaKavod. But there's no ox on the Kisei HaKavod in God's chair. All right, we're learning Kabbalah, but we're going to continue tomorrow.
Excellent. Very interesting. Thank you.
Okay, very good.
Very interesting.